So I'm going to grab my means of asking your questions, but as I do that, maybe Mike, can you give us a sort of very high-level overview of what are the differences between 9.1 and 9.2 in the TOGAF standard?
I can be very facetious and say that if you put the books side by side, you need a magnifying glass to see the differences. However, first of all, there's a difference in philosophy, because for the last 6 years, we've been working on breaking up this monolithic standard, which was really difficult to maintain, into discrete parts. We've now started. You'll notice that the 9.2 standard is a lot smaller than the 9.1 standard. That's not because anything has actually been thrown away. It's been put into discrete parts which sit alongside the core standard. The key areas where we've made changes, we've strengthened the description of business architecture. We've stressed that you don't start thinking about business in phase B of TOGAF. You start thinking about business and the business objectives and the link to strategy before you even approve an architecture project. We've tidied up some definitions. We've got a completely new guide on security, replacing the material that was there, was very good, but was a little bit dated. And we've tidied up the meta model. So for most of you, or for quite a lot of you, meta model doesn't mean much at all. If you are a modeler looking at the 9.1 meta model, you would wonder why we ever had a platform service, because it wasn't linked to anything. So we've done quite a lot there. We've tidied up the meta model. We've added stuff in the business area. But the changes to the core standard are modest. That's because, by and large, TOGAF is no longer a prescriptive method. It's a philosophy for doing enterprise architecture. It's codified common sense, and common sense hasn't changed a great deal in the last decade.
Thank you. Yeah, well said. So one of the things that we've mentioned yesterday and will come up again today is this the concept of the TOGAF body of knowledge, and part of that body of knowledge is the TOGAF series guides. Can you say a bit more about those, Andrew, please?
Yes, we've now, as Mike mentioned, we've started to break information out from the standard, but also add much extended guidance into what we call the TOGAF series guides. I think today there are 7 published, and there are 3 almost due to come out. So if you look at the reference cards, I think there's going to be a list of 10. Yesterday we delivered in the body of knowledge, I think there were over 30 deliverables, which if you then add the TOGAF series guides, makes a total of about 40 documents. I haven't added up all the pages, but some of the series guides now are sort of 100 pages about how you might establish an EA capability, about how you might develop an architecture following the ADM, and so on. So there's a lot more information about how to practically apply the TOGAF standard now out in the TOGAF series guides, and that's an area we expect to expand more quickly than the actual core framework itself. So the standard we would expect to be quite stable, but we'd be adding new and further TOGAF series guides as we go on. I think the other thing to realize is that the TOGAF series guides go through the same consensus process as the standard itself, so they are very much consensus-based documents and have basically the same status as the standard, and therefore we can build things certification around those as well. So you will see, and we'll talk a little bit more about how the certification programs are being extended to sort of cover the TOGAF series guides.
Right, and the whole body of knowledge concept. But the series, it's a good point you make about the series guides. They go through pretty much the same rigorous process as the standards, whereas there's a different track for white papers, but the guides, if they're published in that series, they've really been through the consensus process, which is important to note. Here we are, we've got some questions coming through. Mike, what's the impact? Can you say a little more about the TOGAF library, please?
Oh, yes. Any of you who've been involved in the architecture forum will know that I have been very keen on capturing the ecosystem around TOGAF. I've been producing diagrams about about 5 years. Why is that? Well, you saw some pretty impressive statistics on the screen. The number of people who are TOGAF certified, the number of people who use the TOGAF standard. Now, the reason they do that is not because that one book meets all of their needs. The reason they do that is because that standard is now at the heart of an ecosystem. Many, many, many people have used it, adapted it, deployed it, and more importantly, documented how they deployed it. There is now a wealth of guides, what did you say, 40-ish? 40 documents describing how people have made practical use of the TOGAF standard. That means we actually have an architecture of resources. We've got dependencies. We've got relationships. So one of the things I've been very keen on is in documenting that, promoting it. The TOGAF library is the thing which captures the components of that ecosystem. And we've done a lot of work in the last year in structuring that to make those documents much more visible. So if you're a telecommunications company, there is a document telling you how to use the TOGAF standard in the telecommunications area. If you're in banking, if you're in mining, if you're in defense, all of those things exist. If you want to know how to apply project management to the TOGAF process, it's all there. And it's making that visible, which is a major element of this release. The big value of this release that we've made this week is actually not TOGAF 9.2, it's a TOGAF standard version 9.2, trademark lawyers. It is making visible all of the work that many, many people have done over 6 or 7 years in bringing that standard to life.
Good, thank you, Mike. Next question, ideal for you, Andrew. What's the impact of the new version of the standard on TOGAF 9 certification program?
Okay. Well, what we did originally when we set out with TOGAF 9 certification was actually to build in the capability to cope with, you know, TOGAF 9, 9.1 and 9.2. So the bottom line is that the program is all designed basically to absorb 9.2. There have been some updates to the program, but if you're already certified, you don't have to recertify. Basically, we have a transition period, so courses have 6 months before they have to update to the new standard. If you are studying, you basically have 18 months, because what will happen is we've actually switched the exams right now so that the questions are actually sort of agnostic. They can work for both 9.1 and 9.2. And 18 months time, we may start asking 9.2 specific questions. Why do we pick 18 months? Well, what the reason there is because there's a 6 month period before courses have to overlap, but then you may have an exam voucher which lasts 12 months. That's why we allow that period. So basically, we've got that. It's a planned transition. It's the same as we did last time. If you're somebody who's been certified in the past to TOGAF 9, there is actually now what we call a credential, which is something new that we're introducing in our certification program, which is basically a lighter weight, a smaller amount of learning. In fact, in this case, it's a 3-hour amount of learning that you can do to show that you actually got up-to-date knowledge of what's changed in the 9.2 standard and the ecosystem around it. And in fact, we've got a course on here tomorrow afternoon that Mike is running, which will actually be doing that training and delivering the credential. In fact, all of our trainers within the TOGAF 9 certification program, they are required to have this credential in order to continue training, because some of them may have been, or in fact, some of them were certified originally back in, I think it was February 2009, I think, when we started. So, you know, really we wanted to make sure that, you know, our trainers do have the knowledge, the full understanding of all the changes that we put in place. And we were pleased to see, in fact, yesterday and today, I think we're up to 57 of our trainers have now got the credential as of this morning. And we're probably going to make about 100 before the end of the month of the trainers. So that's our target. And a few people sort of straggle a bit, but some people are keener than others. So that's basically the story with certification. It's a planned migration. It's evolution. Things like the study guides, they have been updated. So yesterday, as part of the release, I mentioned there, I think there were about 30 core documents went out yesterday. But the study guides, the practice tests, these have all been updated and were delivered yesterday. So, and the training materials at the Open Group licenses, they were also delivered yesterday, updated to the 9.2 release.
Right. Okay, thank you. Mike, you mentioned meta model earlier. Questions come in. Have there been any meta model changes to accommodate security concepts such as policy, trust, domains, threat, opportunity, weakness, strength, and risk and control?
Put very simply, within the core standard, no. That is because the core TOGAF standard has to be totally generic. It has to be applicable in every possible situation. And our policy is that if you want to have a style of architecture where you're applying it is constrained, you document that in a guide rather than in the core standard. When we put the TOGAF standard together, we did not necessarily believe that security was a major concern for every company. So security was addressed as a freestanding guide. It is still addressed as a freestanding guide, which was refreshed about 18 months ago. A lot of the concepts that you referred to there are covered in detail in that guide, but not in the basic foundational meta model within the TOGAF 9.2 standard.
Okay, thank you. A couple of questions that essentially are the same. What's the plan for future development of TOGAF beyond version 9.2?
Shall I pick up on that?
Yeah, please do.
Right, we discovered that having a content-driven plan in a volunteer organisation with no assignable resources was non-deterministic, which is why it's taken us such a long time to get to version 9.2. What do I mean by that? I mean, we said, well, we're not going to deliver a new version until we've done this, 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 and this. So just over a year ago, we decided we were going to go on to an annual cycle. We would capture changes, and it's important that we capture changes because we do need to keep the TOGAF standard and the TOGAF ecosystem up to date. But we would capture changes based on the willingness of people to work and contribute. Over 25 years, that's proved to be a really valuable filter about what is important to people. And so each year, we are thinking, our plan is that we will refresh the TOGAF standard. Some of those changes may be very, very minor error correction. Some of them may be, I suppose we would call that maintenance, wouldn't we? Some of them may be minor, and the ones we put in this year are relatively minor. At some stage, we will have a major update, but we won't take a decision on that until we've seen what changes are put together. So we have initiated. I can use the old metaphor of painting the fourth bridge. When you get to one end, you go back and start again. Actually, that no longer works because they've invented new paint, which will last 50 years. However, yesterday morning, we launched TOGAF version 9.2. Yesterday morning, we initiated the review cycle to move for the next 12-month period. At some stage, we will get to the point where we've got something which is substantially different. But we're moving to the point where we are recognising the fact that we do not have assignable resources, and we are exploiting the willingness of people to work and contribute.
And essentially what we have is not just useful, but widely used in the market as is. So. Maybe one for you, Andrew. Are there any other standards of the Open Group cited within version 9.2?
Yes, that was one of the things we did when we updated. So, for example, we've got a lot more references to the IT for IT reference architecture. That's one that springs to mind. I'm just trying to think what other ones there were. obviously a lot of things are out in the guides now, and
of course there are
so things like SOA, that's out in its own guide, and of course that one goes on, you know, we were talking about adaptations to the content meta model, that has details of how you would adapt the meta model.
So we've got lots of references to ArchiMate, but the detail about the relationship between the TOGAF standard and ArchiMate is actually held in a series of companion guides.
And there are ongoing
harmonization activities. We would be looking for more guides to come out in those areas. That's where we're really looking for that sort of thing to be. And models to be developed and so on.
So last question I have right now, unless anyone's got a last minute one, and I know we're going to hear more about this later when Brian Lale talks, but what are the most significant changes in the business architecture domain? Mike, is that one for you?
Yeah, in version 9 of TOGAF, there were lots and lots of throwaway lines in the description of Phase B. We talked about business capabilities. We talked about value chains. We had a brief reference to operating models. It didn't mean a great deal because there was nothing behind it. Now there is, because we've got a very active business architecture group within the Architecture Forum who are picking off these topics one by one. They have published a guide to business capabilities. They've published a guide to value streams. They're very close to publishing a guide on business models. So they're working on that, and we've taken advantage of that to strengthen the descriptions. What is a value stream? What is a capability? How do you relate capabilities to value streams? Importantly, we put in information about how you actually relate this stuff to what the business actually wants to do. So we had goals. We've now got an important concept called a course of action, which is what we're going to do to address a goal. And a course of action means identifying how you build up the value, how you build up the ultimate value to stakeholders, to customers, a value stream, what business capabilities you need to enable that value stream. So that's all built in now into the TOGAF standard and with the detail in the associated guides. And as I said earlier, a very important step is actually stressing that the first versions of that stuff, the value stream diagram, the business capability descriptions, has to come before you get sign-off for your architecture project, because that's the context. It has to be done as part of the visioning. You don't leave that until you say, oh, well, we're underway, let's get some business architects in now. They have to be involved in the planning right up front.
And those new concepts of course of action and so on tie very well to the strategy part of the ArchiMate modelling language that we brought in with 301. So it's actually, even though we didn't say explicitly ties with ArchiMate, obviously it does some of that, and some of it's gone a little bit ahead of ArchiMate because we've got value streams and stages, and that will be coming soon in ArchiMate as well. So it is all sort of tying together.
Great stuff. Thank you, gentlemen. There's a question just come in. There are still many differences between ArchiMate 3.0 and TOGAF 9.2 in architecture type and meta model. Will they gradually converge in these two aspects?
The answer is
favorite question.
Gradually converge. The question I have is it necessary for them to converge? Because the TOGAF standard and ArchiMate were developed by different groups of people for different purposes. We do need to identify the implications of using the TOGAF standard and ArchiMate together. But we also need to recognize that they can be used separately. You don't have to use ArchiMate. And we also have to recognize that the TOGAF standard has an installed base. 65,000 individuals who've got TOGAF certification. Was that the figure you gave me yesterday, Andrew?
67,000.
67, all right, that's close enough for me. What we don't need to do is to have artificial convergence that makes life difficult for 67,500 people if there is no real business benefit. So So that's the driver here. We're converging where we need to, but not treating it as a religion.
Right, thank you. Gentlemen, we'll leave it there for questions. Just one last opportunity to plug the session this afternoon. The credentials?
That's tomorrow afternoon.
Tomorrow afternoon, okay.
This afternoon we've got an architecture forum meeting, which you're welcome to come on. That is tomorrow on credentials afternoon. As well. But
The afternoon session today
members.
Is for members, particularly aimed at people who are accredited training providers, because we believe that the TOGAF credentials program offers a business opportunity. And we'd like to engage people in the extension of the credentials program.
Okay. And then tomorrow afternoon we have training.
Yeah, TOGAF update training tomorrow afternoon, which will lead for those people who are already TOGAF certified can actually be then entered into the Essentials credential, which is a very lightweight assessment, very easy, gets you up to date with your knowledge and can get you then one of our new shiny badges that we're deploying.
But that is very important because, as Steve hinted earlier on, of those, the people who've got TOGAF 9 certification, there are those who did it in February 2009 and haven't come near TOGAF since. And there are those who are actively taking effort to remain up to date. That credential enables you to put alongside your TOGAF 9 certification an indicator that you have taken the trouble to maintain your knowledge of TOGAF.
Excellent. Gentlemen, we'll leave it there. Thank you very much, Mike Lambert and Andrew Josey. Thank you.